Well, good morning. I love the friendliness that we have, the community that we can have because of Jesus Christ. And that community draws something out of us and calls us into something greater. And I'm grateful for the way that the Lord uses that in our midst. I think most of us remember the story a number of years ago, June 17th, 2015. Dylan Roof entered Emmanuel Church in South Carolina, Charleston, South Carolina. And as the group of believers bowed their heads to pray, he pulled out a gun and began to shoot them at point-blank range. 9 people were killed in that church, including the pastor, one of the workers of the church. Many faithful volunteers and faithful members of that church were killed, all because of an act of hatred and a man who was far from the Lord. A few months later, at Roof's bond hearing, the judge gave the opportunity for many of the friends and family of the victims to come speak and address Roof directly. First came the daughter of Ethel Lance, who was killed by Roof. She approached the stand and spoke clearly, but through tears, "I forgive you. You hurt me. You took my mother from me." Then she turned and said, "God, please forgive him." Turned back to Ruth. "I forgive you." Then another, whose family member was killed, came and said the same words, "I forgive you for this act of hatred." And another, "I forgive you." And another, "I forgive you." Another, "I forgive you." Finally, "I forgive you and pray that you would repent and turn to Jesus Christ. He can save you. He can forgive you of your sins. Only Jesus can do that." You see, a deep faith that believes Jesus can change anyone moves me to reconcile with everyone. Let's pray. Father, we are grateful for your word. We're grateful for the situations of life that you give us a glimpse into these eternal perspectives. God, we thank you that even in the heartache, we see that you're moving. And Lord, would you take your word today and make it move in our hearts, Lord. Help us to see one another as you see us, to forgive one another as you've forgiven us, to reconcile with one another because you have reconciled us to yourself through the blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. It's in his name that we pray. Amen. Well, go ahead and grab hold of your Bibles and turn over to Acts chapter 9. We are continuing in our series, Unsung, Ordinary People, Uncommon Faith. And we've been learning about deep faith from people in Scripture that we don't normally talk about. People that are usually brushed over as a side character. I think I know what that guy did. I'm not really sure. But we're taking some time because there's a lot of things that we can learn from these people, these unsung heroes of the faith. Today, we're going to be talking about Barnabas and his reconciling faith, the faith that Barnabas had. Much of what happened in the early church could not have happened without Barnabas working behind the scenes, without Barnabas's strong faith reconciling others to one another. So let's begin reading Acts 9:26 through 27. It says, "And he," when he, that's Saul, we'll get there in a minute, "when he had come to Jerusalem, he attempted to join the disciples, and they were all afraid of him, for they did not believe that he was a disciple. But Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles and declared to them how on the road he had seen the Lord who spoke to him, and how at Damascus he had preached boldly in the name of Jesus." A deep faith that believes Jesus can change anyone moves me to reconcile with everyone because, first, reconciling faith believes that God works in others no matter their past. Reconciling faith believes that God works in others no matter their past. As we said, this he that we're talking about in verse 26, this is Saul. Now, Saul, also known as Paul, if you continue to read the book of Acts, you'll hear him called Paul a lot more. We know him as that. Saul is his Hebrew name. So especially when you're talking about the Jews, his name is Saul. But he also goes by Paul, which is more of his Roman name. So just for to clear up any confusion, it's not that his name was changed later. He has both of these names, Saul, Paul, same guy. Is called Paul when we're talking about the Gentiles. Later, most of his ministry goes towards the Gentiles, but this is very early in his ministry, and so we're still told that he's called Saul here, and there's much of the Jews that he's interacting with here, so the name Saul is what's happening here. But earlier in this chapter, if you remember just the very first part of chapter 9, the little text above the 9 in my Bible says, the conversion of Saul. So Saul is on the road to Damascus. Now, Saul was a Pharisee. He says that later in some of his writings. He's a Pharisee. So Jesus had some words to say to the Pharisees. They weren't all great. That's who he would be talking to, is Saul. And so Saul is then on this road to Damascus. He actually has in his possession letters that were sent by the Pharisees so that he could imprison and beat and even kill Christians. That's his whole job. That's why he's going to Damascus, and on the road to Damascus, he meets Jesus Christ. You should go back and read this when you have some more time, but it's an incredible conversion that Saul has here at the beginning of chapter 9. He's miraculously saved. Then he goes into Damascus. He meets Ananias. It's a really cool interaction there, and then it says that he's preaching the gospel. So this guy who was in opposition to Christians now is the biggest champion for Jesus Christ. But he's preaching in Damascus, so much so that just before our passage, it says that the Jews were plotting to kill him, Saul, and they're watching the gates day and night, all those sorts of things. And it says, but his friends took him by night, led him down through an opening in the wall, lowering him in a basket. So can you picture this? Like, put Saul in a basket and lower him down the wall so that he can escape from these people. Now, these are like the same people who said, go kill the Christians. But now that he's preaching for Jesus Christ, they want to kill him. And all of this happens. So he escapes in the night from Damascus and goes right here to Jerusalem. This is what's happening. Galatians 1 tells us that this account that we're reading is actually 3 years after he's saved. So even though it's about 15 to 20 verses in our Bible in chapter 9, it's about 3 years later since Paul has been converted. But the disciples here would have definitely heard the stories. So here's this guy who was coming to kill us, and supposedly he became a Christian. And then he's in the synagogues preaching. They've for sure heard this. This guy used to be our biggest enemy. What in the world? Now he's saved? Really? He's even preaching for Jesus? Look at the text. It says that they were afraid of him, for they did not believe that he's a disciple. It's sort of like, it's a trap. He's coming, he's just trying to spy on us. He wants to throw us in prison. He wants to kill us. He's not really a believer. Not that guy. You see, we look at the end of the story because we know what Paul did later. We know all of the books of scripture that he wrote. We hear the stories. You have the maps in the back of your Bible that have those little dotted lines all over them and see his missionary journeys. But this is before all that. They just know this guy, Saul, who kills Christians. Now you want to bring him here? No, I don't believe it. Think about it for a minute. These disciples who were in Jerusalem, how many of them were friends with Stephen? Remember that story? That wasn't too many chapters ago. Saul's holding the coats of all the guys who kill Stephen, one of the first deacons of the church. How many of them were good friends with him? How many of them had family members that were killed because of Saul? How many of them maybe still had bruises on them from when Saul had them beaten? How many of their family members may even still be in prison 3 years later because Saul showed up with some letters and said, these people are following Jesus, they need to go in prison. You see, they felt this. He wasn't just some guy who wasn't great. This was somebody against them. Do you know where he's been? Do you know the things that he has done? Not this guy. Not around me. That's how they would feel. You see, it's easy for us to accept Saul. It's easy for us to be like, no, come on, guys, you just got to make up here. But you have to feel what they felt. You have to feel the outrage. You have to feel the no way, not him. Maybe I'll be nice to this guy over here, but not Saul. But that's where they're at. See, who's that person that's hardest for you to love? I doubt many of us have had friends or family members who have been killed by someone in the name of Jesus. I doubt many of us have had to face a murderer of a friend. Maybe you have. But who's that person that they walk in the door and your blood just kind of boils a little bit? You're like, oh, her again? And it brings back all of those very unhappy memories that if we're honest about it, we feel all of those things again when that person comes into the room. We have people whose past is anything but a happy memory for us, but we can't allow ourselves to lack faith that God can work even in them. Because after all, he's worked in me, and he's worked in you. And the things that we have done against one another and the things ultimately that we have done against the Lord, we're the outcast. You see, we need to be the most accepting people of those who are not like us. And so many people would come into a church and would say, I don't want to be around those Christians. They're so truth-filled. Which is true. We are. And I'm grateful for the truth of God's word. But the thing that they should feel, the thing that our lost friends should feel is, well, I don't know. I don't really agree with all the crazy things that that guy says, but he's really loving of me. He accepts me for who I am, and maybe he tells me some things in God's word, and I don't really agree with those things, but he's not a jerk about him. She loves me. She's accepting of me. Those are the things that someone should feel about us. Are you welcoming, I mean really welcoming, of the person who doesn't look like you, doesn't come from the same place that you come from, doesn't dress like you dress, doesn't talk like you talk? I mean, don't get me wrong, we wouldn't say anything. Quentin and I were talking this week. As Americans, we're far too polite for that. We would smile, and we might even shake their hand at the front door as they walk in the church, but inside, I'm like, who's this guy? What is she wearing? Where has he been? We might think all of those things, even as we smile, but the Lord looks at our heart. And we need to truly be welcoming and reconciling of each person because God has worked in me. He's reconciled me to Jesus Christ. And I know what I was like before Jesus Christ. And so we can welcome one another as Christ has welcomed us. Barnabas doesn't act that way. He reaches out to Saul through this. Look at verse 27. It's a beautiful two words that begin that verse. What does it say? But Barnabas. Those are beautiful words. Despite what others believed, Barnabas believed that God could work in anyone, even Saul, even this guy who's murdering us, even this guy whose whole job was to come kill us. God can work even in him. Barnabas steps out. Now, he's also known as Joseph. That's also his name. Barnabas literally means the son of encouragement, and many of us have heard that before, but this is a specific way that Barnabas is acting out that encouragement. He's reconciling them together. Barnabas is a Levite. He is a native of Cyprus, so he's a Jew there, which puts him in a good place to talk to Saul and these disciples here. But Barnabas is first mentioned in Acts 4 for his incredibly generous gift. And we look over it pretty quick because we think, yeah, I got some stuff I could sell and give the money away. But Barnabas sells a field that belonged to his family and gives all of the money to the church. Now, it is a huge deal. Property ownership was huge back in their time. Now, remember, he's a Levite too. So even in the Old Testament, the Levites didn't have a lot of land. So for him to sell what he had that was his by inheritance and then give all of that to the church, that's huge. I think we read over it pretty quick like, oh, yeah, he gave some offerings. No, this is big, like probably top three giver in their whole church. That's Barnabas. But his generosity isn't just financial. He's not just generous with his resources. He's also generous in his graciousness towards one another. Acts 11:24, a little later, would say that Barnabas, he was a good man, full of the Holy Spirit and of faith. Because a generous heart full of faith leads us to gracious reconciliation. And here, in this passage, his discernment about Saul and his desire to reconcile came because he walked closely with the Lord. He believed what God could do. He had seen God work and knew that God could work in anyone. And secondly, reconciling faith proclaims God's work in others, no matter the risk. Reconciling faith proclaims God's work in others, no matter the risk. Now, it's interesting. It doesn't just say that Barnabas thinks these things. He actually takes action. It says that he brought them to the apostles. This is likely, we know from later passages, it's likely Peter and John. We think of like this massive group of all these apostles. When it's talking about the disciples, I actually believe it's talking about a larger group of people. Paul's trying to like join their church, and they're like, no. So Barnabas then takes Paul and brings him to the apostles. Probably, it's probably just like Peter and John sitting in a room. And Barnabas walks in. He declares to them. He met Jesus. He preached boldly. It's so amazing to me because Barnabas doesn't like overlook any of his past. He doesn't even mention his past. No mention of his past. Just forgiveness. No mention of his past. Just what God has done in him. It doesn't matter what he did 4 years ago. It doesn't matter the awful things that he has done against Christians. Only matters what Jesus Christ did in his life. And too often we would look at our own lives, maybe even the good things in my lives, as sort of a trophy of like, look, Lord, look at this amazing thing that I bring to you. I'm the best writer ever. I'm so good at loving others. I'm really good at hospitality. And we sort of bring that gift to the Lord. The thing that we need to be known by is the fact that we are sinners redeemed by a perfect Savior. That's what Barnabas focuses on. He doesn't even talk about all of the other things. Saul probably had the whole Old Testament memorized as a Pharisee. He doesn't say, like, this guy really knows the Bible. You should trust this guy. He doesn't go to any of that. He just goes to the fact Jesus met him, and then Jesus has used him to preach the gospel to others. That is the reward. That is the trophy that we are to be known for. No mention of his past, just what Jesus had done for him. And Barnabas risks here. Barnabas goes out on a limb for Saul. Remember, Barnabas is like, he's in here. He's with the disciples. And yet he goes outside and sticks his neck out for this guy. Now, as far as we can tell from Scripture, he didn't know Saul. It's not like they were good friends yet. We know later that they become good friends because they serve together. But as far as we can tell, he had heard the stories about Saul, probably just met the guy, and believes that God worked in him and can work through him. We often aren't willing to risk ourselves for one another. Top five reasons we aren't willing to risk it. The first, doubt. I think a lot of times we allow ourselves to be paralyzed by all our over-analyzing of all of the information in front of us. So wait a minute. I know that he was killing Christians. And then he met Jesus on this road. What kind of a road was it? And what exactly did Jesus say? And what exactly did Paul say when Jesus said that? Was anyone else there? We start asking all of these questions, analyzing all of this, and it brings us to doubt. We just sort of the paralysis by analysis sort of thing. That I don't act. I don't step out. I don't risk anything because I'm not sure about all this. There's maybe some more information that I need to get. I'm not sure about all this. And so the doubting keeps us from risking it for others. Number four, pride. Listen, this guy doesn't deserve it. I mean, for all he's done, he's not worthy to be a part of our group. It's fine. We sort of see ourselves as better than him. So, you know, maybe he's a Christian. I don't even care. But, like, listen, whatever he's like now, for all that he's done in the past, he doesn't deserve it. And our pride gets in the way. Three, unbelief. Whatever. There's no way. Not that guy. I don't care what he's telling you. He is smoking something. There's no way that guy met Jesus. I mean, I could believe this guy over here, and she's pretty good, so I think the Lord could use her, but no, there's no way that the Lord met him and could use him. And then number two, busyness. I think this is the hardest for many of us in our Western world, is I'm just, you know, I'd love to stop and help somebody. I'd love to spend the time and the energy to help someone else that really needs it. But I just, have you seen what my schedule looks like this week? I mean, we got baseball practice, and I got to get my daughter to ballet, and then I have this work meeting on Tuesday night, and then now you're telling me I got to come to the church and pray on Wednesday night, and then I got small group on Thursday night, and then I have way too much to do. I can't do it. Well, someone else will take care of it. Someone else who has a less busy schedule. And that loops back into that pride thing. We feel that we're important and that my schedule is more important than the person who's right in front of me. But I'm unwilling to risk it for another person because of the busyness that I have in my own life. The number one reason is fear. What if I stick my neck out for him and the apostles not only reject him, but reject me? What if I stick my neck out for him and I'm wrong? I mean, he has done a lot of bad stuff. And so what happens then? Is he going to kill us? How's the Lord going to use that? What if it costs me too much? What if I'm wrong? God, what are you doing here? And we just let this fear keep us from stepping into loving relationship. I don't have a list for this because there's only one thing on it. The number one reason to risk it for others is love. A love for others that is born out of a love for Jesus Christ and a deep faith that believes Jesus has changed me, he can change anybody. And that is the thing that drives us to that. Bob Goff said, "It will be the people with the greatest love, not the most information, who will influence us most to change." And we need to be loving people who reconcile one another to each other because of the reconciliation that has happened. Now, the apostles, they have plenty of information here. They've heard of Saul's story. They're the people in charge. They know all of the information. They know a lot about him. But Barnabas has a love for Saul. He sticks his neck out for Saul and proclaims God's work for him. It's interesting, too. I wonder how many of us would have listened to Barnabas. So Barnabas comes in and starts telling this story about Saul, about how he's turned to Jesus Christ, and now he's following the Lord, and we should let him in. How many of us would have been like, "Great! He can have the seat right next to me." Or would we be like, "Let's wait on that a little. It's only been 3 years, so I don't know. I want to see how that goes a little more. I want to make sure, maybe let him be in another church first and see how that goes before he comes in here and starts killing people." I don't know. You know, it would have been very safe for them to keep Saul outside the church. It would have been comfortable for them to have him outside the church. Think of the attacks that they probably got from other Christians at the time. You let him into your church? Do you know what he did? But Barnabas looked past all of that and stepped out and risked it for Saul because of what Jesus Christ had done. But look what happens. Barnabas doesn't just believe these things. He takes action. Look at the text. What does he do next? But Barnabas took him. He went and got Saul. I can see him there with his arm around Saul. How is Saul feeling with all this? He tries to get into the church, and they're like, "Nope, door's locked. We're full." But Barnabas goes. You can just see him with his arm around him. I'm like, "Come on, man. Come on, let's go." He takes him. He goes to get him. Have you ever done this with somebody? Have you taken somebody who's new at work and kind of showed them the ropes? The coffee maker's over here, and you know, Gladys is a little weird over there, but she's great. You just be nice to her. And you know, Bill loves to talk about his cat, so if you ever want to, you know, like, and don't get on the boss's bad side on Thursday. That's always a rough day for, you know, like, sort of showing them the ropes. But, like, come on. Have you ever taken a new believer and met with them over coffee and talked to them about how you follow the Lord? Many of us would feel like, I don't really know what to do. I haven't been to school for it. Just meeting with somebody. Well, I don't know. I usually, this is the Bible reading plan that I'm going through, and I keep a prayer journal, and I'm not the greatest at it, but this is what I do. Just sort of showing them the ropes. Just, come on, man, come on. It's like this. That's an encouraging thing that we can do to one another. Have you ever taken a newly married couple and shared all of the mistakes and all of the joys in your marriage and encouraged them to live their marriage in a God-honoring way? Have you ever seen a lonely person and brought them into your group of friends? We all have the image of the new kid at school who's sitting at the table at lunch by themselves, and the person who steps out of their comfort zone and goes to get that young girl and says, "Why don't you just come sit with us?" But that's what Barnabas is doing here in an even more significant way. And we can risk ourselves for others. He took him. He went to go get him. We need to be looking for ways to encourage others as Barnabas did. But then secondly, he brought him to the apostles. So clearly Barnabas had some kind of in with those apostles. Maybe it was because of his generosity and faithfulness through the years. They knew they could trust this guy. We know him as the son of encouragement. Had he spoken words of encouragement to Peter when Peter was going through difficult things? Had he visited John in prison to encourage him? Maybe. But because of that in, they respected him. Now, it's not in the text. It doesn't tell us why they listened to him. But I believe it's because of his godly character, because of his faithful track record. They're like, all right, I'm not so sure about this Saul guy. But if Barnabas trusts him, I can trust him too. And he's able to use his influence to build a bridge between Saul and these apostles. The next thing that he does is he declared to them. Do you see that there in the text in verse 27? Barnabas took him and brought him and declared to them how on the road he had seen the Lord. Listen, our words matter. Barnabas didn't just hang out with Saul and say, "Oh, it's okay, don't worry about it, maybe they'll come around." He actually took action. He walked him over and said the specific words. How often do I use my words to tear down someone else? How often do I use my words to build myself up in someone else's eyes? But Barnabas was determined to use his words to encourage, to use his words to build up someone, to use his words for someone who couldn't have words for themselves. It wouldn't matter how much Saul tried to talk to these guys. They weren't letting him in. They didn't believe him. So Barnabas used his words to speak for Saul, to speak for someone who wasn't in a position to speak for themselves. No matter the risk, Barnabas proclaimed God's work in Saul. And lastly, reconciling faith releases God's work through others for multiplied fruit. Reconciling faith releases God's work through others for multiplied fruit. Let's read the rest of this section, 28 through 31. So he went in and out among them at Jerusalem. That's Saul now. He went in and out among them at Jerusalem, preaching boldly in the name of the Lord. And he spoke and disputed against the Hellenists, but they were seeking to kill him. And when the brothers learned this, they brought him down to Caesarea and sent him off to Tarsus. So the church throughout all Judea and Galilee and Samaria had peace and was being built up and walking in the fear of the Lord and in the comfort of the Holy Spirit, it multiplied. You see, this is the outcome of Barnabas' speaking up, of taking action, of risking himself for Saul. Saul goes and he begins to preach to these Hellenists, that's Greek-speaking Jews, and he's offending them so much that they want to kill him too. Now, do you remember that? Back in Damascus, they're trying to kill him because he's speaking about Jesus Christ. But what's so amazing to me is who stands up for him here? Look at the text. Who stands up for him here? It says the brothers. It's the same guys who Barnabas just convinced to let Saul in. So Barnabas speaks out for Saul. And they're like, all right, fine. If Barnabas trusts him, we'll trust him. And then here we are. How much longer was that? I don't know. I don't think it was very much longer. But they trust him so much now. They've accepted him so much because of Barnabas' word that now they're protecting him. They're like, this is our guy. We can't let these guys kill him. He's got more preaching to do. He's got more work for Jesus Christ. Do you see how it releases the work for Jesus Christ? None of that would have happened if Barnabas hadn't have stuck his neck out for him. He's our guy. We got to look out for this guy. Great fruit came through Paul. and through the church at Jerusalem. Who knows what would have happened if Barnabas hadn't have put his neck on the line and reconciled Paul and these apostles. You see, sometimes our unwillingness to reconcile with someone, sometimes our unwillingness to reconcile is a barrier to God's work happening in its fullest potential. I don't want to be a barrier. I want to be an encourager that releases God's work into others and multiplies fruit for Jesus Christ. We know the rest of Paul's story. Man, what would our Bible be like without Romans or Corinthians or Galatians or Ephesians or Philippians or Colossians or Thessalonians or Timothy? Oh man, what would ministry be like without the book of Timothy? Or Titus or Philemon, all these books that Paul has written, what would our Bible be like without all of those truths that we have? Saul wrote all of those, and he was able to do that because he was reconciled to these believers, and they were on the same team, and that happened because Barnabas made it happen. How many churches were planted because of Paul? How many billions of people all the way to today have heard the gospel because Paul went out on one of those squiggly line ministry journeys in the back of our Bible? Billions of people have heard about Jesus Christ because of that. It all started with a little word from Barnabas, and a small but bold action by Barnabas to bring him in. Barnabas made this happen. He stepped in with his great faith, stuck out his neck for a murderer who opposed the church, but was gloriously saved by Jesus Christ. Who knows who wouldn't have heard the gospel if this hadn't have happened? And I think for all of us, who's the person that you can step out and encourage this week? Who's the person who might be on the sidelines, or you might think, I'm not sure the Lord can use them, or they're, I don't know, it's just difficult over there. God's word calls us to reconcile to one another, to act like Barnabas, to use our faith to reach out to someone else, because God can use them for his purposes way more than we could ever know. There's an old statement that says, you can count the apples on a tree, but only God knows how many apples are in a single seed. You don't know what's going to come from all of that. This is a picture of Edward Kimball. Ever heard of him? I hadn't until this week. He was a Sunday school teacher to a group of hyper boys. I can kind of see that. I have two of those hyper boys. But Kimball was determined that he was going to take a personal interest in each and every child. That every person, I'm going to get on their level, and I'm going to teach the gospel to them, and I want every single boy in my group to accept Jesus Christ. One boy didn't really seem to care about any of the lessons. He didn't seem to listen. He was one of the exceptionally rowdy guys. And so Kimball took some extra time and went to the boy's work at a shoe store. And that boy, D.L. Moody, gave his life to Jesus Christ. Moody preached, and thousands came to Jesus Christ because of his ministry. It's a pretty good school right by the cathedral that exists because of him, because of D.L. Moody. But one of those who were brought to Jesus Christ by Moody, by his preaching, was a guy named Wilbur Chapman. Later, Chapman became an evangelist himself and also preached the gospel to thousands of people. And one day as Chapman was preaching the gospel, there was a professional baseball player who had a week off and decided to come to the meeting. His name was Billy Sunday. He was miraculously saved through one of these evangelistic crusades. He quit baseball and determined that he was going to preach the gospel. There's some crazy pictures of Billy Sunday. He would, real athletic guy, I'm not going to do this today. He would jump on the pulpit, like standing flat-footed, jump onto the pulpit, holding a Bible, preaching for salvation. This guy was fired up. It's pretty cool. I would have loved to have been there. But Billy Sunday goes and eventually takes over for Chapman for his crusades, and he's preaching again to thousands. As he preached the gospel, a young man named Mordecai Ham came to Christ and later became an evangelist himself. You see this long line? It's incredible. And one week, Mordecai Ham came to preach in Charlotte, North Carolina. There was a lanky young man with blonde hair who refused to go to the meetings. And eventually, he was talked into it. After hearing Ham give the gospel on two separate occasions, Billy Graham gave his life to Jesus Christ. It's estimated that 2.2 billion, with a B, billion people have heard the gospel from Billy Graham's lips. All of that happened because of one Sunday school teacher who took an interest in each boy in his classroom and was faithful to proclaim the gospel, to reconcile them to Jesus Christ. You see, you never know the impact that you can have by a simple, faith-filled, bold action done to somebody you think that God couldn't use. Barnabas wasn't a guy with his name in lights. We only know about him because of the way that he's encouraged others, because of the way that he's put his life on the line to reconcile others. That's how we know about Barnabas and how we can be encouraged, because of the way that he sought to reconcile others. What's so beautiful about this, too, is 30 years later, after this account happens, about 30 years later, Paul himself would write these words. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old is passed away. Behold, the new has come. All of this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us this ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us this message of reconciliation. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us. We implore you, on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. Paul was so transformed by what Barnabas had done in his life in reconciling him to these believers that he called for us to act in this ministry of reconciliation. Jesus Christ has brought me near to him. And so we can act to bring others near to one another. A deep faith that believes Jesus can change anyone moves me to reconcile with everyone. Let's pray. Father, we're so grateful for your word. We're grateful for these small glimpses into uncommon faith. Lord, the way that you work in miraculous ways, the way that you work through simple and seemingly small but bold actions for Jesus Christ. God, we thank you for the way that you've reconciled us to yourselves, that you have not looked at our trespasses, not looked at what we've done in our past, but have only looked at what Jesus has done in our lives. God, would we act in that same way? As we seek to reconcile people to you, would we be ministers of that reconciliation, carrying it to a world that desperately needs Jesus Christ, that doesn't need to be corrected in all of the things, the ways that they live, but needs to be seen the gospel, the beauty of Jesus Christ on the cross for their sins. God, would you do that work through your Holy Spirit? Use us. God, help us to take these small but faithful steps. Help us to see the people around us that need encouragement, that need reconciling, that need to be brought to one another. Lord, would you use us in these ways to grow your church for your glory in Jesus' name? Amen.